Good to see you, Guido. Hope you're well.
Yes, Sanjay. Thank you. Good seeing you too.
Great. So you're going to present us today a detailed look into Aixtron's business model. But before we start with that, may I ask you to please introduce yourself quickly, and then we just jump right into your detailed presentation.
Thanks, Sanjay. Will do. First of all, my name is Guido Pickert. I'm VP Investor Relations and Corporate Communications at Aixtron. I joined the company in April 2007 and went through very, very intense developments of the company. And I'm here now to present you the growth path of the company that we're on right now.
Great. So the floor is yours.
Thanks, Sanjay. So let me start with the basics of the company. We were founded in 1983. We're a spin-off of the Aachen Technical University, one of the best universities in Germany. And the vision of the founders at that time was already looking out into LEDs, because this is one of the areas they looked into. And their vision was that LEDs will become a commodity that everybody will use every day throughout their whole life. And I would say their vision of 1983 has literally come true. We see LEDs everywhere in our lives, in lighting, in cars, in really in closets, you name it. Really, it's all over the place. And this was actually what they foresaw already at that time. And this was the basis of their activity and the company. So we're worldwide present. We have the majority of revenues generated in Asia, which is why we are present there as well. And we have our production facilities here in Germany, but also some in the UK. We are around about 700 people worldwide. And from the beginning to now, we've sold more than 3,500 deposition systems for the industry. And in most of the markets that we address, we're by far partially technology and market leader. I will get to the different markets that we address in a bit. Let me quickly address the areas of activity in general of our technology. We are a deposition company that offers equipment to deposit certain materials on a basic material. So usually those basic materials or the substrates are wafers made of different materials, such as sapphire, of gallium nitride, of silicon carbide, or of silicon. So there's different wafer materials that our customers can use in our tools, and our tools enable them to deposit chosen materials onto these wafers, and not only on one, but on several wafers at once. So, to really combine what we do, we are a pure play compound semiconductor player. Why do I emphasize this? It is because usually people think when they talk about semiconductors, think about the classical silicon semiconductors. These are the base materials that are used for chips that we know in processors, logic, that we know in memory. And they're continuously pushing this development further. We are in a different segment. We are in the segment, as I said, of compound semiconductors. And this means combination of different materials to get to a certain property. So we do this with the help of, for example, metal organic vapor phase deposition, or MOCVD, or CVD in general. We do this with plasma enhanced CVD, and we do it with organic vapor phase deposition in the area of OLED or organic materials. As I said, our market positioning in MOCVD is very strong. We are a world market leader in this space, and we intend to stay that as well going forward. So what is it what we do? Maybe I quickly run you through the different areas that we address, and please be aware of the fact that nearly all of these areas are very, very, very intense, strong growth markets. So it is not that we go into saturated markets and try to be the next offerer of something. No, we are addressing growth markets, and in many cases we are the enabling technology to make possible what these markets are intending to do. So let's start with one of the markets for lasers, for example. Lasers are used, solid state lasers are used for machining, for example, in a smaller scale, but they are also used for data communication. So everybody wants glass fiber, everybody wants fast data availability. And if you choose for glass fiber networks, you need light to be sent into the glass fiber network, and this light is generated on lasers and also amplified through lasers over longer distances. And you can be very sure that these lasers in these networks are made on Aixtron tools. And the second part of the laser business that has a very strong growth potential is lasers for sensing or 3D sensing. So there are certain ideas of entrance control, trying to scan faces or eyes or something like that. This is one area, but a very prominent area that we've seen that our customers have been buying capacity for is what's called face ID or 3D sensing in mobile phones. So if you own an Apple phone that is, or an iPhone that is iPhone 10 or younger, then you have usually on board what they call face ID. You look at the phone unlocks, and then or it unlocks certain transactions, for example. And this is made possible through a laser, through a vertical cavity surface emitting laser or VCSEL. And this technology has been introduced with iPhone 10 in 2018, I think. And there again, you can be sure that these lasers that enable this functionality are made on our tools. And the good thing is we see not only that this is happening on the so-called face side, i.e. the part of the phone that you look at, it's also now happening on the backside that enables you to scan certain objects to really bring the real world into the digital world. And this is again made possible with lasers, and Apple has introduced this functionality and called it LiDAR. By the way, LiDAR will be a technology used also for automotive purposes when your car has to make sure that it knows what's happening around it. And this usually encompasses laser scanners, again, with lasers made on our tools. So we see strong growth potential here from the first initial wave of capacity buildup back in the days of 2018. LEDs, I talked to you about it already. The vision of our founders have made different steps of growth and adoption in the market. And here we've always been at the very front of the development. When it came to really high volume manufacturing of LEDs, the Chinese players have come in and they've addressed the market of what we call commodity LEDs. We've pulled ourselves out of that because of the low prices offered in this space. And we concentrated on what we call specialty LED areas, or we build on our market leadership for the manufacturing of red LEDs. This is important because when we talk about a display, color display, you usually need three colors to form a color pixel. This is red, green, blue. Some of you might know it by RGB. And I told you about the commodity LEDs, which is green and blue, actually blue. And we are the ones that provide equipment to make the red, so the complement green and blue. And we see demand continuing and coming up again for the what I call display evolution. We all know these huge stadium displays that are out there. If you would get too close to them, you couldn't just see anything but flickering LEDs. But the industry is continuing to make these displays available for closer distances. This is called fine pitch displays or mini LED displays, meaning LEDs become smaller, the distances between the LEDs become smaller, and you can get closer to the display and still see a picture. And again, RGB, red, green, blue, red from us, green and blue from China. And as I said, good business for us. The future in LED, in LED displays, it's what's called micro LED displays. This is an area where industry players, major industry players, are investing millions and millions of dollars to develop the capability of making micro LED displays. Why is this so complex? Because the LEDs, single LEDs, are so small, they're even smaller than the diameter of a hair. So this means new challenges for the industry in order to be able to manufacture displays in a mass manufacturing or in higher volumes. And we can tell you that the industry is making huge progress. So we will at some point see products like a, let's say, a smartwatch made with a micro LED display, or on the other extreme, a very large display for home cinema purposes, for example, based on micro LEDs. So the large displays are addressed by companies like Samsung. They work together with a smaller company that is actually our customer. And then the other extreme is seen by, for example, Apple, that is working very intensively in developing the manufacturing possibility or feasibility for micro LED displays. Maybe they will come to the market by 2023, and production will have to be built further up front. So maybe a year, 1.5 years ahead of that. This is what we're looking at, and this is where we see substantial growth potential in the area of LEDs. The other area that our customers are addressing and we are addressing with our equipment technology is what's called power electronics. Everybody knows power electronics. Everybody knows the chargers. Everybody knows the transformers. Everybody knows these chips that take care of changing between AC and DC and the different voltages. This is based. This is the prerequisite for many things that we do today. The power electronics today are mostly based on silicon materials. And what's new is that new materials, much more efficient materials, are entering this market and are taking away market share from silicon. And these new materials, or so-called wide band gap materials, they address either lower to middle to medium voltages or high voltage applications. And they're called gallium nitride for the low to medium voltage. And they're called silicon carbide for the medium to high voltage application. In gallium nitride, this is a very interesting material and a very interesting time, because it seems that what's called the tipping point has been reached of adoption. So the industry is really now investing into capacity to be able to produce so many devices that at a cost efficiency that they can replace silicon-based technology, because what gallium nitride can do is do the same thing as silicon, but much more efficient and much smaller. So this is the energy efficiency driving it, and the form factor in things like chargers. We all know these big old laptop chargers that they're from the past, almost as big as a brick. This can be made so much smaller with GaN technology or GaN tech or GaN power, whatever you want to call it, that this is now the time where industry is really focusing on. So this is happening today. What's also happening today in the area of higher voltage applications is silicon carbide entering the market and gaining market share versus silicon. Silicon carbide is the same principle as gallium nitride, making the same things, but much more efficient and reducing the energy loss, meaning you need less energy to convert between AC and DC. For example, when you switch between a battery or electrical engine or the charger. So these kind of things that are very, very important, for example, in an electric vehicle, those can be made more efficient, smaller, and more resistant against heat, generating a better performance and a longer range with silicon carbide in comparison to silicon. This is the market we're addressing with our technology as well. We are let's say, entering the market with a lower market share in strong contrast to all other markets where we have a dominant market share. In silicon carbide, we are building our market share by introducing and getting our technology into the market that promises to be more efficient and with a higher throughput and lower cost for the customers than the existing products. So this is what's happening today. Electric vehicles are adopting silicon carbide, will be adopting silicon carbide once they hit the road, in addition to what's happening today already with Tesla. Another area that I would quickly like to address is our, let's say, option. We have an option going on with a technology called OLED deposition, or OVPD. This technology is offered by our daughter company, Apiva, and we're undergoing a very stringent qualification project with one of the largest display manufacturers situated in South Korea. And this qualification project consists of three major phases. One is the lab phase, which is done. Second is the phase of bringing from lab into pilot manufacturing. Recently, we've announced that this is also done. Now we are in discussions with the customer of how and when to enter the final phase. And if that's possible, if that's successful, then we can offer tools that are more efficient in manufacturing something like OLED displays, for example, for TVs or for mobile phones. From the financial point of view, we are profitable. We have target margins, gross margins of around about 40%. We have a fairly fixed operational expense position, meaning that when these markets that I just described, that are definitely growth markets, when one or more of these markets start to reach the tipping point and adopt the new technologies, then we could see us entering into a growth phase again, which is what we expect over the next years to happen. So the profitability on the bottom line will clearly be positively affected by stronger revenue growth at the given gross margin and a fairly stable cost base. So that could be very interesting over the next years, depending, as I said, on the end markets to develop.
Thanks a lot, Guido. It was really good to have you on our Seed11A platform. It was a very detailed and interesting presentation. I hope we will continue the Aixtron series with a factory tour and a product presentation over the time. And thanks a lot again, and see you soon.
Thank you, Sanjay.
Hi there, since you watched this company video until the end, I'm guessing you liked the video. And that's probably because we work very hard to create the most engaging and added value content for you. If you're a company and want to find out how we, at Seed11A, can make a company video with and about you, please email us at content@seed11a.com.